Let's welcome in our next guest on the show. Inderjeet Bhatia from Macquarie now joins us. He's recently released his strategy note. Inderjeet, thank you so much for taking our time for us. Could you just tell us that what is markets trying to factor in with the recent fall that we have seen from the highs, more than about 10-12% in dollar terms? What are markets trying to factor in?
Hi, good morning, Pankaj. Pleasure to be on the show. I think there are three things. One is obviously the domestic factors, where post demonetization we should see a sharp cut in earnings for FY17. There could be some impact going into FY18 also. So that is one. The second is the global factors in which the post US elections, the dollar has been kind of fairly strong. So there is going to be naturally outflows from emerging markets. So the global factors are also being factored into the markets at this point of time. And I think the third thing is in the initial days of demonetization, there was a lot of expectation about a large one-time gain to the government, which have kind of dissipated to an extent. So there is also a question mark about the ability of the government or the room that they have to kind of push through spending into FY18, on which basically the entire turnaround in FY18 is kind of placed at this point of time. So with each passing day, and as more data comes in about that maybe the bounty that government was hoping for is actually going to be much smaller, that also puts strain on the government's ability to spend. So I think these are three factors which are being priced in or are being tried to be priced in the market at this point of time.
Right. In terms of valuations at 8,000, looking in at FY18 numbers, do you think that markets are extremely cheap, or you believe that FY18 numbers are also optimistic and that could see meaningful EPS cuts?
No, definitely. We believe FY18 numbers are still much higher. So when we did our analysis somewhere in late November, the consensus earnings growth for Nifty was roughly around 8% for FY17 and roughly around 17 to 18% for FY18. What we believe the realistic numbers are going to be more like 2 to 4% for FY17, and on that lower base, maybe closer to 12 to 14% kind of growth in FY18 is a realistic number to work with. So definitely FY18 numbers will also get cut, and hence maybe the multiples have not come down significantly below long-term averages.
Right. Do you think bank deposits, what are the withdrawal data, any sort of tax returns that happens initially will be the first data to watch out for? It may not be a market moving data, but it's a data which will tell us where, you know, where the flows are going or where essentially earnings are going.
I think more than earnings, now very short-term earnings are clearly going to be impacted by this demonetization exercise. So I don't think market is going to get too worked up on those numbers. But I think the data to watch out for in the month of January would be if the government is able to get any large disclosures under this whole IDS2 scheme that they have kind of launched. If that comes out to be okay, then the market should stabilize, because then the government has much more room to kind of spend into FY18. But if that data is also weak, then clearly there is no near-term earnings support coming through for the market. And hence, we could see test new lows into next quarter.
Right. And the cash crunch situation, when will it ease? How will it lead to ease of doing business? Very difficult to predict now. So Q4 numbers mostly should be, again, weak, similar to Q3?
Now, it's difficult to say whether they will be as weak as Q3, but the whole cash crunch obviously would continue to have an impact into Q4, maybe another couple of months' time before this thing starts to kind of ease off. But what we are looking at is that Q4 earnings should kind of look at maybe not as bad as Q3, but definitely would be weaker than what was anticipated before, say, November 8th.
Right. What happens in terms of global uncertain environment that we are in? So, you know, with what's happening into US, the new president will, of course, give his first speech once he takes charge. You know, a lot of changes are expected over there. all of that could also have meaningful impact for flows into emerging markets, including India?
Look, I think once the new administration takes charge in US, I think everybody would want to keenly follow as to what the key initial policy prescriptions are. Are they going to be as harsh as what the rhetoric was during the election days? And if that is so, then obviously the fears of protectionism, trade barriers will start to rise, which obviously is not a good news for emerging markets.
Right. What do you do if dollar index continues to go up or continues to, you know, see this strength? Do you think it will be negative for flows, or investors would, you know, want to shift towards US because rates are going up over there, and plus you have, you know, dollar index, which is quite strong. So the dollar returns may be decent.
So I think if the dollar index continues to go up, obviously within India, there would be expectation that better sectors to look at would be the export sectors, which could be IT and pharmaceuticals. But if I look at from a rupee movement till now, I would say rupee has been one of the strongest currencies in the relative to the other emerging markets. So the currency is kind of fairly held up well in the last month or so. And we do not expect too much of depreciation from these levels. We expect that the rupee will gradually go back to or go to somewhere closer to 70 kind of levels, which should not be a bad news for India's exports. But obviously, a continuing dollar strength would be negative for emerging market flows.
Right, but rupee at 70 will actually lead to better earnings outlook?
Look, a very large part of the Nifty earnings do come from export-oriented sectors. So our sense is even if rupee goes to somewhere around 70, it might be more neutralish rather than being bearish or more positive for the Nifty earnings. Another factor here is that we don't know how much of the rupee benefit some of the sectors can retain, somebody like IT or pharmaceuticals. Now, over the years, they basically use the benefit to kind of pass on that cost and passed on that benefit to their customers to kind of gain more market share. So we need to see how that plays out over the next few quarters.
Right. Mr. Bhatia, you previously said that, you know, of those three triggers that you're watching out for, if they don't play out as expected, markets can make new lows in the coming quarter. What levels are you looking at?
Sorry, I didn't. Can you repeat the question?
Mr. Bhatia, you said that you listed a few points. One was the IDS scheme, and you said that if disclosures aren't too good, then the markets could be disappointed and they could correct. What are the levels you're looking at?
I think if I look at one from the market levels, maybe another 5 to 7% correction, maybe even up to 10% correction is something. It cannot be ruled out, but for that to happen, a lot of negatives would have to play out. Things like government's ability to spend not being there. They're still coming out with a very populist kind of a budget. The revival in economy clearly getting delayed. So I think if those factors kind of play out simultaneously and along with global factors, then maybe we could see another 10% correction. But
right.
Our sense is that it might not go down that much.
Right. Relatively, you said the Indian markets have held out versus the emerging markets. Now, there's also a view that the US markets plus the dollar and the bonds have run up too much, and perhaps now's the time for a little bit of correction. Should such a correction happen, will emerging markets really benefit? Do you think there's any support from this kind of theory?
Look, I think if I had to look at India, at this point of time, the domestic factors are kind of clearly more important than what's happening only in the global side. So I think isolating just what would happen to the dollar index is not a kind of a great idea, according to us, at this point of time.
All right, then, Mr. Bhatia, what would instill that confidence in the FIIs to relook India again. You said that there are a number of factors. If they turn negative, markets could go lower. But what are the positive triggers that could work in India's favor and instill the confidence in the FIIs to start buying again? You said valuations are not much lower than their long-term averages. But then India always gets a premium for its growth. Do you think growth will be a reason? Do you think the pace of remonetization will be a trigger? A lower rate of capital, if RBI cuts rate, will that be a trigger? What will instill confidence in the FIIs to relook at India?
Okay, now if you look at India, I think from an FII perspective, they all agree that some of the steps taken by the government, be demonetization or the impending GST bill, these are long-term structural positives for India. So things will definitely improve going into second half FY18 and post that. So I think it's a question about valuation at this point of time. Some of the quality names, if they correct a little bit more, I think there is a decent amount of FII interest waiting on the sidelines to kind of buy these names. So obviously valuation is one. But I think other factors which FIIs would continue to look for is, as you mentioned, pace of remonetization, to kind of what extent normalcy can be restored into the business climate into quarter four. And as I again said, budget. I think budget would be kind of a fairly important indicator to the markets this time around. If the government can find room to kind of spend more, and that too on more capacity building areas, on more productive sectors, I think then clearly the markets would stabilize at those levels.
Will stabilize. Okay, let's talk about the budget. You said FIIs will look at good quality stocks. And if the budget is positive, if the government does go out with a spending plan, what are the sectors that you think will benefit? What are the good quality stocks you think will benefit? Will it be largely the large cap stocks?
So we are kind of more on stock, bottom-up stock-specific approach rather than just look at large caps or mid caps. But what we are looking at in terms of sectors, clearly we believe two themes which will play out going into 2017 or FY18, the way you look at it. One is clearly the rural recovery. What we believe is the government would spend a significant amount of money into rural into next fiscal year. The rural will also recover much more sharply because the two strong, very strong crops, both Kharif and Rabi. We believe the cash flows will start to improve with the farming economy somewhere around March and April. So the pent-up demand will get released. So the stocks related to the rural sector should kind of do well. We also believe that the domestic cyclical recovery kind of stocks, so stocks related to construction, infrastructure, they can also do well going into next year. We also believe, along with GST, another very strong theme which can play out is companies which benefit from shift of unorganized market into organized player. So be it in manufacturing sector, be it in the finance sector, I think some of these sectors will benefit from GST longer term. So these are the stocks that we are kind of looking at this point of time.
Right. We'll continue our discussion with the kind of stocks you like. But one question I had was, if the government comes out with a spending thrust in the budget, do you think it will stick to its fiscal consolidation path? If not, if they say that, okay, we'll take a little bit of leeway, would that be viewed very negatively by, say, the rating agencies?
I think, one, we expect that the rate of fiscal consolidation will slow down into FY18. India has been cutting fiscal deficit at a central government level from almost close to 6% levels to down to 3.5%, which is the expected level in FY17. We do not expect that rate to continue. The government might kind of look at a number which is around 3.2 to 3.4% kind of a number going into next year. I don't think market will be kind of too bothered about a 20, 30 basis point higher fiscal deficit than what was originally envisaged in the consolidation plan. But if the number is kind of way off than that, then the market will start to kind of get worried.
Right. You mentioned about companies which will benefit from the unorganized sector going away. Now, let's just take an example of Havells or, maybe a Voltas. You may not give a call if you're not allowed from your compliance. But, in terms of these businesses, there is a lot of unorganized markets which will, as GST comes out, as probably demonetization plays through, it will lead to their competitiveness reducing versus a Havells or a Voltas. That could lead to great market share gains and business profitability. Is that something what you're looking at?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think generally the low ticket consumer discretionary items have a large unorganized play. So the big white goods, maybe like television, air conditioning, these sectors anyways do not have too much of unorganized play at this point of time. But a lot of the home improvement stories have a large play in terms of unorganized sector. I think looking beyond your typical consumer or manufacturing sector areas, you also have sectors like financials. So if you look at the non-corporate lending, a very large part of that is in the hands of unorganized players at this point of time. So we believe the banks or NBFCs or microfinance companies which have reached into the rural areas, which can use their or leverage on their digital platforms, I think these would be the companies which will kind of gain market share in the post-GST and post-demonetization environment.
Right. Any of these companies, where the raw material cost can increase quite significantly, because last year, majority of the surprise did not come in from volumes, but from margins going up because of commodity prices being so low, especially for the consumer durable pack. Do you think that will fade out and that could lead to a disappointment?
I think anyways, this year, the expectation is not that these companies will continue to see another round of margin expansion from low raw material cost. A lot of commodities started to kind of inch up somewhere late 2016 itself. So the market expectations of the continued margin recovery purely from raw material cost anyways was not there. I think we would want to watch out for if there is a negative surprise, if some of the commodities clearly ramp up significantly going into 2017. But I don't think that is anyways built into the into stock prices too much at this point of time.
Right. I was just looking at your top picks. It's HDFC Bank, Hero Motocorp, L&T, Hindalco and ITC. There's no IT name into that. Valuations are very attractive for IT. Dollar index, probably is likely to go up further. So margins could be good. US is expected to grow. Why not be overweight on IT?
Now, a couple of reasons. One is we've taken a kind of a long-term 12-month view, then clearly we would want to stick with more domestic themes. We still believe that FY18 will see a kind of a decent recovery in the domestic economic climate. And in that kind of a scenario, we would want to stick with the domestic plays. Maybe in the very, very short term, tactically, some of the IT names kind of do well. But I think even IT is kind of facing headwinds. Typically, early January, February is when a lot of the clients of IT companies finalize their budgets. And that kind of starts to come in terms of guidance or in terms of kind of indication as to how the next year is playing out. But I think given the election year in US, the new administration would have taken charge only in late January. I think the companies there would also want to wait out before they decide as to how they want to spend into next year. So the decision making from the clients in the IT sector would also get delayed, I think, which will continue to add uncertainty to that space. So that's why we are kind of equal weight. We're not too bearish on the space, but we do not have an overweight in that sector at this point of time.
Right. In terms of US recovery, would pharma be one of the key sectors to look at? Dollar index goes up there. They also have a lot of exports, plus with US markets or bullishness over there, a lot of derma products from some of the companies like Sun Pharma can do well, which may be counted as FMCG on slightly in terms of valuation. So do you think pharma would be positive?
So actually, pharma, the benefit from US is going to depend on two things. One, obviously, some benefit from the rupee depreciation, where again, our view is that it's going to be a much more measured move towards 70 rather than a sharper depreciation. The second thing is a lot of these pharma companies, it's about the company-specific issues. So be it the regulatory issues or their own pipeline in terms of clearances, that needs to kind of play out rather than looking it as a sectoral kind of an approach. We at this point of time actually have underweight on pharma because we believe the regulatory issues, except Sun Pharma, most of the companies have already seen their regulatory issues kind of already cleared. For them, additional triggers at this point of time is going to kind of be difficult to come through. I think Sun Pharma clearly is one stock which we like at this point of time because we believe that in the next 3 to 6 months, their regulatory issues could get sorted out. We do have some mid-cap pharma names in our top picks. But as a sector as a whole, we have underweight on pharmaceuticals.
Right. How would you want to play the domestic story, you know, I mean, in terms of mid-caps? Can you just tell us, you know, probably as you said, consumption, as you said, rural. Can you just be more specific, maybe not taking the stock name, but, you know, in terms of consumption also, there are a lot of sectors. So how would you want to play it? And would you want to play with the, you know, leaders in those particular segments?
So, for example, if you look at the top picks that we have, Hero MotoCorp, according to us, is clearly a big beneficiary of a rural turnaround going into FY18. So they should benefit. Within our rural theme, we have names like Mahindra and Mahindra Financials. We also have names like HDFC Bank. So they should. These kind of companies will start to benefit as the rural starts to do much better going to next year. Even within consumer names like Marico could benefit from that side. So any company which is kind of more leveraged on rural side across sectors, be it financials, be it consumer discretionary, be it autos, financials, I think these are the ones to kind of look out for.
Right. You know, in terms of capital goods or in terms of infrastructure, last 2 to 3 years, you know, every analyst, every company has been expecting a pickup as far as infrastructure spending is concerned. Do you think demonetization with the sentiment that is as low as it is right now, do you think this would just be delayed and very difficult to say when infrastructure spending would pick up?
Okay, I think if you look at on the broader CapEx recovery theme, one is the private sector investment continues to remain kind of fairly weak. And we continue to expect that at least for the next 18 months, 24 months, we do not see any signs of significant pickup on the private sector capex. Now let's look at the infrastructure spending. Now, I don't think demonetization has anything to do with that. I think it's more to do with how much money can government afford to put into spending. Last year's government's own capex growth was around 4% in their budget. So if government is left with the theme that I've been talking about is that post this demonetization and expectations of higher tax collections, better, higher tax to GDP ratio kind of going forward, if the government has room to spend more money on capex, on infrastructure, then I think finally some of the stocks can start to see some benefit of that come through. Anyways, I think even on the sector that we have discussed earlier in the past, like roads, we believe that finally we should start to see all these awards which have been happening in the last couple of years. They start to move into a kind of a decent execution mode from late FY17 or early FY18 onwards. So I think that will start to see give some support to some of these sectors, some of these stocks. Another important theme has been that a lot of the good quality names in this sector, they've been using the last 2-3 years to kind of solidify their balance sheets, bring down their, cut their assets, which are non-core to them, bring down their interest cost. I think that also is going to be a decent driver for earnings for these stocks going into FY18 and 19.
Right. Do you think rates need to come down more for that pickup or that confidence? Or is it really about the business momentum picking up rather than the rates in the system?
I think rates coming down is more of a signaling to the economy. We don't think that a 50 basis points cut is necessary or is the only thing necessary to kind of boost the investment cycle. I think you need the economic momentum to kind of improve in the system for generally corporates at large to kind of be more confident to go out and spend on capacity creation. So I would rather monitor utilization levels, volume growth for the companies rather than just look at interest rates going forward.
Right. And do you think that, spending from government can pick up in terms of infra, and that in turn will at least mean, largely a lot of work coming in for contractors, may not be big player like L&T, but smaller players can benefit?
No, I think our base case kind of remains that the government would ramp up spending on infrastructure going from FY18 onwards. And I think contractors of all sizes will benefit from that. So I would not exclude any player from that list. Any contractor who's willing to kind of work with the government directly should benefit. Maybe we'll not see too many of those old BOT type projects. So where developers might not see too much coming through their way, but the contractors could continue to or would see some pickup in the work available in the market.
Right. And, what do you make of cement as a sector? So, in 4 or 5 months, whenever we've spoken to any FII who's overweight on cement, they say that one of the ways to play India's GDP growth story is the cement pack rather than infrastructure, because they are not clear when the pickup would happen. But whenever it will happen, cement will benefit. Do you think that cement, after the recent correction, that comes in as a question mark, and now infrastructure valuations are better versus cement?
No, I think we've always said that in a way cement valuations had kind of extended themselves too much. They started to become more closer to kind of consumer kind of valuations rather than a commodity type valuations. We continue to believe that today infrastructure is a better way to do that, play the entire recovery. I think cement, clearly a very large part of the demand comes from the real estate sector. There are concerns now as to how the real estate sector would be kind of impacted because of demonetization. So obviously at this point of time, we do not think that the cement is the best way to play any recovery in the investment side, especially from the government side going into FY18. So we'll rather stick with either the infrastructure companies or maybe select financials over cement at this point of time.
Inder, thank you so much for taking out time for us. Always a pleasure.